Welcome to the satsang. We're taking a little time here to cool down. That's the invaluable service. A little time to cool down. We're not furiously discussing, you know, the events of the world. The events of the world don't matter at all. The most valuable asset this world has is someone in this world who is completely indifferent to the world. That is the truth. Complete indifference to the world. Where nothing that is happening is traumatizing their experience at all. They're feeling no trauma. Whether people relate to this or not doesn't traumatize them either. Whether they help anyone or not doesn't traumatize them. That is the greatest asset we have in this world, is that which we should come across in today's time. I've been lobbying for this for a long time, for about 15 years. I've been lobbying that the world, this is what the world needs. Someone or many who are simply experiencing unconditional love, and all the effects of the entire universe have no effect on their experiencing whatsoever. None. Not even a ripple. That is by far and away the most helpful, valuable asset this world has. True ally of truth. The greatest ally of truth. And I haven't been able to find anyone that is still alive today that is like that. Where absolutely nothing affects their experiencing of delight, of unconditional love, because they know that they're experiencing the effect of a different idea. They're not saying that they're of the world, in the world, and of it too, and somehow mentally they're able to be over the world, all the trauma. Saying, look, I'm experiencing the effects of a different idea. And if that effects of that give rise to unconditional love, and you can do this too. That is how to escape the drama and the suffering of the world. Simply choose a different idea. Don't think you have to somehow train your mind in some way. Change your mind to see trauma, to experience trauma, but not react to it, or to remain calm in the face of all this trauma. No. Choose a different idea, and you will literally be experiencing a trauma-free effect, which is a positive thing. It's not like you're defending against trauma. You're defending against trying to react, you know, defending against it so that it doesn't bother you. Trying to defend so that this calm remains with you. All that defensiveness that we think is a you know, indicative of a strong mind, that is not what we're attempting to do here. Forget about the strong mind. What does that mean? Mind is infinitely creative. There's the idea of strength. It doesn't even enter into it. It's a servant. It carries out its service perfectly, always. So simply choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, and you get this overlay of unconditional love. Experience that effortlessly. There's no trauma there. There's no effort to block out trauma. There's no effort to escape or avoid it or do anything about it. It's just not being experienced. Because it's not arising as an effect within that idea. Now the overlay is aware that all this trauma is all this stuff is going on, all this activity, but it's not being experienced as trauma. It's kind of like more like a dream. Everything is going on stuff, but it's just a dream. Look, it's like that. It's being overlaid by this feeling of perfect serenity and non-trauma. And that is the true remedy for any time in this world. It's a remedy for now, any time in the past, any time in the future. Same remedy, always. There won't be development of some other remedy in the future. So why are we not going with it now? We're thinking, well, in the future there might be something even better. No. Reality is set. Reality isn't going to come up with a new set of laws. So what is true now has always been true and always will be true. And the only way to not experience something that you don't really want to experience is to choose a different idea that has its experiencing one with it. That's the only way. There are two ways. And the destructivity that's coming upon the world, you're seeing it now, is just the tip of the iceberg. It's been fomenting and building, and the great chess game of planetary sacrifice is underway. The pawns are being moved now. You know, you maneuver the pawns around, then at some point the knight starts, you know, being moved. And what else is there? The rooks, the castles, you know, all this stuff is moving around, and it gets more and more intense until they start going after the king, that type of thing. So there is this great chess game taking place in front of our eyes, and we can have to choose, will we go into a blame game? Who's responsible for all this? You know, who was asleep at the wheel? Who's, you know, who, all this political bickering and it's going on, this intense bickering. Who do we scapegoat? Who do we make an example of? Who do we get rid of so that this is all remedied, you know? That kind of scapegoating, it is very foolish. It's better to say, look, the world, this is what the world is. The world is destructive. It's inherently destructive. The universe is inherently, the purpose is destructivity, to develop the power of destructivity. That's its purpose. You can say, okay, I don't really want that. Okay, then what I would do? I'll choose a different idea. One that doesn't give rise to a universe whose purpose is destructivity. That's the only way. You cannot tilt at windmills in a universe, in this universe, and try to get rid of, you know, destructiveness. It's never happened, never will happen. We've been at it for how long, really? Throughout the universe, how long have we been at it trying to come up with something we really want here? We say, oh, we want peace, 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 peace. Of course we want peace, but well, that's the universe. Never. We want to be free of trauma, this fear of trauma, fear of vulnerability. How can we ever get that in this universe? Universe is nothing but vulnerability. So, we need to produce the right result, what we really want, we need to choose a new idea. It has a different effect. It gives rise to a different effect. No vulnerability. No trauma. Perfect peace. Perfect stability. Unchanging. Eternal. All this. This is the effect that we want to experience. In order to get that, we have to choose another idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator. There's no way around it. We cannot have the idea of trying to be prime creator and not experience all this trauma, loss, suffering, death, insecurity, vulnerability, instability, doubts, depressions, all of this comes with it. It's a package deal. Cannot have one without the other. Cannot have this idea of wanting to be prime creator without trying to generate this threat to reality. And we use ourselves as guinea pigs to... We use the symbols, we symbolize ourselves, and use these symbols of spirit to, as guinea pigs, to determine how potent loss, the threat of loss is at any given time. We're trying to build it up, more and more potency. More and more potency. We develop better and better symbols, you know, of the spirit. Spirit develops better and better symbols. It's like the human body is supposed to be a very, very effective symbol. It's supposed to have some, you know, strong symbolic importance. And then so then testing out the power of negation, of destructivity, the threat of loss on these personas and bodies, we feel it's a very good test run, very good test run. That's all that these bodies are here for. We put them here. God didn't put bodies here. God didn't put personas here. Spirit, with this idea of wanting to be prime creator, mind has to turn that and give experience. And so mind is orchestrating all of this. And it's all hypothetical scenario. And in this hypothetical scenario, we keep developing more and more sophisticated symbolizing reality and identity, so we can keep assessing the threat. How strong is the threat? How potent is the threat? By using all these forms as cannon fodder for this threat assessment. So everybody's here on this planet is simply put here by mind. Everything is simply straw men, symbols, bodies, personas. All that is simply symbolic of spirit. And then we are subjecting the symbols of spirit to severe stress and destructivity. And to assess just how potent, again, destructivity has become. Just how potent is the threat? Can it really threaten reality? And so we need more and more sophisticated symbols to test out. And this whole human thing is supposed to be a very sophisticated one, and spirit's very interested to see how it's able to, how destructivity is able to destroy, you know, humans, great number of them. And out of this, it hopes to gain the crucial insight and the power to threaten the prime creator. We're just spirits, just using all of these bodies and personas, personalities, again as guinea pigs, nothing more. It's like again a waking dream, kind of like a simulation. All this is just like an experimental, a simulation, almost like a digital, you know, a digital simulation, if you want to put it that way. Some people will say the Matrix, you know, the Matrix, a simulation. It's all a simulation. It's a what if, a plausible scenario, hypothetical scenario. What if these bodies really represented spirit, and this world represented reality, and what if this were so? And then subject all this to loss and say, ah, okay, maybe there is some power that can destroy reality, and so we can use that to threaten the prime creator, to change reality for and make us prime creator. The more sophisticated the guinea pigs are, the more stronger our belief comes that this is possible. When we see humans being brought down into the ground, we think, wow, humans are very sophisticated and smart, and yet they too, look what happened to them, crushed. So it's plausible to believe that maybe reality, then this can threaten reality. That's the unvarnished truth. You know, we mind doesn't tell what's going on. It hides it all, and we, you know, the personas all pretend to be happy, like animals, you know, you want to keep them healthy, clothe them nicely, give them stuff. Just, we're like rats in a cage, and you know, being treated in various ways, subjected to various things, and then our reaction to all this is being assessed. Our suffering is being assessed. The trauma we experience is being assessed, not by God at all, but by spirit. God isn't paying attention to the universe, knowing it's just a dream of trying to develop a power of negation and threat. God knows that reality cannot be threatened, so why would God pay any attention to this ridiculous scheme? But spirit pays a great deal of attention to it, believing that this is the, you know, this is the laboratory, this is the workshop, this is where it gets done, and believing that for sure it will get done. So everything seems to be very important, like it's necessary to set up these big experiments. Experiments are happening all the time in existence, but we have one that now that's set up to be a very big experiment in assessing the potency of a threat. That is what's happening in the world. That's it. And, you know, it's kind of like you have lab animals and you're planning to subject them to some severe trauma. But before you do that, you want them to be healthy, vigorous, happy lab animals so that the threat assessment is a valid one. Because after all, we believe it will be threatening reality, and reality seems to be, might be in, you know, very good shape. So we try to make sure that we're fed right and clothed right, and everything is, you know, going along well for us. So that then applying the threat, it will be sort of a realistic simulation of reality, because reality is, again, going along blissfully, unaware, totally happy, delighted. That's what reality does. So in order to assess to see if reality can be threatened, we need to kind of simulate that. And so we have all these people, and we seem to be happy and smiling, and we go shopping and go out to restaurants and movies and watch entertainment. People seem, you know, like well-adjusted and happy and well-adjusted. So that when the trauma comes, it will seem more realistic. In other words, God is totally oblivious to any threat or to existence, the universe. So it's almost like a sneak thing. We think we need to practice. How do we institute this threat, unless it's done in a, you know, sneaks up on the Prime Creator, because the Prime Creator is not paying any attention to any of this. So we kind of practice that. We practice sneaking up on ourselves, on these bodies, a sneak attack sort of thing. It's very important, because again, the Prime Creator is apparently oblivious to all this. No threat whatsoever. And so we think, okay, that's the Prime Creator doesn't think there's anything wrong, no threat whatsoever. So we need to practice that. We need to have a population here of all these sacrificial victims that's in this world. And we need them to all be oblivious to what's going to take place. And want them to all be happy and carefree and feel like, wow, the world's really kind of a good place. I really like this. And just be, you know, completely unaware of what's suddenly going to come upon them. And that's how we're simulating, trying, you know, assessing the potency of threat. That's a way of simulating the idea of trying to attack reality, which is just seems to pay no attention whatsoever. It seems to be just totally delighted and happy and not worried the slightest bit. So again, everybody in this world, the simulation wants everybody to be happy, not worried, you know, don't worry, be happy type of little jingle thing. So then when the threat comes, and wham, you know, it'll be catch everyone by surprise, so severely by surprise. And then assessing how everyone reacts to that, we feel we'll have a better assessment of the threat as it applies to reality, how it's going to apply, how we're going to institute it. Which is why you have, you know, most people in this world are paying no attention to, you know, the troubles that are coming. They're pretending like everything's getting better. Yeah, everything's fine. That is all a setup. Nothing more than a setup. And then those who have, see through this whole thing can speak out about it, but most people are not that interested. So this is why you see the world, everybody's pretty nonchalant about everything. Very nonchalant. But those who see through this whole setup, they're the barking dogs, sounding the alarms. Hey, everybody, wake up, you know. This is a sneak thing. It's a surprise thing. It's gonna happen so quick. So quick. Catch everyone by surprise. And everyone will wonder, how in the world could I be caught by surprise? Because all this is just a controlled experiment. It's all controlled experiments. All being set up that way. And the entire human persona thing is just a construct. It's just a patsy for all of this. That's all. All of this is just patsies for what's going to take place. But we don't have to be a patsy. We don't have to go along with this experimentation. Because we know there's no such thing as any threat that can ever threaten reality. And never we can never develop it. So this is just a total waste of time. Useless. The data acquired is useless. Totally useless. Throw it in the trash. Completely waste of time to even accumulate or compile any of its data, let alone try to crunch numbers and try to, you know, come up with some conclusion. Utter waste of time. And so we do not have to go along with it. You just keep telling yourself, no. Choose a new idea instead. And therefore, there's no need to assess any the potency of any threat. See, everything in existence, really, we're assessing the potency of threat. If you look at your life, that is true. That's called judgment. We're always judging how potent is this threat, how potent is this, okay, and then balancing and trying to maneuver, okay, this is a little less threatening and traumatic, and this is a little more, so I'm going to steer this way. So we keep steering and navigating our way through existence. Simply assessing, you know, what is the potency of the threat and trauma here? That's a fact. That's all that existence is. We are we're engaged in this huge undertaking that we have tried to ennoble and gild and say is so, so vastly important. In fact, we love to tell tales about how they're, you know, sojourners from all over the galaxy that are here looking at this planet, and there may very well be, and how we're told that the whole essence of the universe rests upon what's going to happen in this world very soon. Will the world go this way, or will it go that way? And we're told that, yeah, this the whole crux of the universe, the universe is in the balance, and if things go right for the planet Earth during these times, the entire universe is going to somehow graduate into and be elevated into something vastly more wonderful and greater. But it all is hinging on what happens here on planet Earth. We can translate that, give a translation of that. And what that really means is that there's a profound belief in the extreme importance that to find some catalyst that'll catalyze, turn the hypothetical into an actual, make this threat to reality, make it a real threat. And so we're desperately trying to bring that about. And so we're hoping and believing that this final planetary sacrifice here will be such a potent sacrifice that it will actually bring about this catalyzing effect, and that will make the threat real. And then God, the Prime Creator, will have to relent, have to make a deal, and has to change reality so that we're Prime Creators, and then things will be like unbelievably great for us. That is what the belief is really. That's the belief that's really taking place here. That's behind the whole situation. It's behind it. That's what's sustaining it. That belief. That finally the sacrifice is going to succeed. And so, in other words, saving the whole universe, meaning all this effort will finally no longer be needed. No more death, no more dying. We'll have wrapped it up, finished it, because we'll force the Prime Creator to change reality. This is all nonsense, you know. It'll never happen. And yet that is hope. That is what we're resting our hopes upon. But it's false, absolutely false hope. So this is the big picture type of thing, of seeing through the whole setup here. Everything is a setup in existence. It's all a setup. It's all experimentation. It's all a process trying to manufacture this power of threat, of loss, of destruction. And we keep throwing, you know, more and more into the kettle and into the pot, some kind of vast stew, you know, throwing more and more sacrifice in, you know, into the pot. We think finally this sacrifice now will be the final ingredient, that somehow the soup is going to taste perfect once we throw that in there. It's going to catalyze it like some kind of, you know, something catalyzing jello. Was it pectin or something? I don't know what it is, but it catalyzes jello and solidifies, solidifying agent. We don't have to go through that trauma, but we need to see, why is it that everyone in the world seems to be kind of nonchalant? All right, that's very important. That's all part of the setup. They're playing the role. Their role is that of playing the naive, nonchalant one who is unaware about what's about to happen. It's that one that's walking down the forest path, you know, singing a song, skipping, and so happy, and it's great. And here you are, you know, on high, looking down, and you see that the savage beast is there, is going to jump on him and devour him. And just, you know, just down the road, they're hiding in the bush. And yet here comes this, you know, happy-go-lucky persona. Not a care in the world, carefree, naive, and you know what's going to happen very soon, but they're pretending like they don't have a clue. The world is like that. The world is pretending like it doesn't have a clue what's going to happen, even though what's going to happen is an open book. It's very well known. Because spirit wants to assess the potency of a surprise threat, surprise trauma. Very important. 9/11 was a surprise trauma, supposedly. But some were aware of it ahead of time. Because everything, again, what happens in this world is actually an open book. You can read that book and know ahead of time what's going to happen. But very few do that because they say, oh, that would ruin my whole purpose for being here. Because my whole purpose for being here is to be preyed upon in a complete surprise manner. You know, be traumatized in a surprise manner. Because if I saw trauma and where it was coming, I'd make steps to avoid it, or at least to mitigate the trauma to a large extent. So people here, they don't want to hear. I used to be able to tell people the future. They didn't want to hear. That's what really tipped me off to what's taking place here in this world. One of the main tip-offs is I had so much precognition. It was just amazing. To me, the future was an open book. I could just read that book and know what's going to happen. And I would tell people, hey, here's a trauma coming up. I see it very clearly. This is what's going to happen. And they got so mad at me. They got so mad because they didn't want to know. They didn't want to know. Why? They want to assess the potency of a surprise threat, surprise attack, surprise trauma. A trauma that comes about without any warning. They want to see how does that, how potent is that? Because we believe that, again, the Prime Creator is seems to be completely unconcerned with any threat. And so we think that whatever the threat we do, we have to spring it upon the Prime Creator, will come to a total surprise to the Supreme Creator. So we're trying to simulate that surprise, a threat coming upon someone that's by, and trying to find out how will they act, because we want to know how the Prime Creator is going to react to all this. And so here I am coming and say, hey, you know, trying to be a friend, trying to spare people trauma. And I say, look, I can tell you right now what's going to happen. And they say, oh, you know, oh, you're crazy. They say, you're crazy. What are you doing? And they got real angry. And, you know, why? I say, why are you so angry? Well, now we know. Like, again, they feel like their purpose is ruined. Waste of their time. They want to assess a sudden, unexpected trauma. So they don't want to know about it ahead of time. And if you really explain what's going to take place in this world, not many people want to listen. They don't want to. Do not want to listen at all. They feel that they'll ruin their game, ruin their experiment. They're trying to assess the potency of a surprise attack, surprise trauma, a trauma that someone is not looking for at all. In fact, a trauma to that which appears to be so naive and not even thinking about the possibility of trauma at all. That's what they want to. That's what we want to assess now. So, the more people here who think everything's fine, everything's getting better, no trouble, not in such bad trouble, future should be great. You know, all this Pollyanna-ness, I don't know how to say that. Pollyannishness, there you go. All of that is intentional, it's by design. So we all have all these quote-unquote innocent victims in the world. Innocence suddenly preyed upon, that type of thing. All of that. Again, and a lot of people wonder, why do good bad things happen to good people and young people, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's all the same reason. Assessing the potency of attack, of trauma, of threat, in all sorts of different ways. A little child, you know, gets traumatized. They think, oh, it's awful. But that, too, is part of this play of assessing trauma. How does it work out? If there's someone like this child suddenly traumatized, you know, because the prime creator again is entirely innocent and not seemingly naive and like a child, like an infant, not even concerned about trauma in the slightest bit. So everything that happens in existence is intentional. It's by design. It's a threat, potency of threat assessment, is what it is. All these victims, you know, that they have to realize, you know, everyone has to realize this is what's really going on, and they don't want to, because they say that'll ruin their experiment. That is a fact. You know, I mean, like I said, I used to be able to see what's going to happen. I say, hey, I tell someone, I just say, hey, I can see that tomorrow you're gonna, you know, get in this big trouble or an accident or whatever. They look at me like, huh? You're crazy. You can't stop. You know, it's terrible. Shut up. And I don't want to hear it. And they say, what? And then it would happen, you know. I'd say, "I told you so." And they look at me like a, you know, hateful look, like, "Yeah, you ruined it for me. You ruined it for me." Bizarre, you know. I've noticed that. I've noticed people that they even told me they want to be victimized. They're seeking victimization. I said, "What are you doing?" Of course, they say, "No. This is what I want to do." You know. And now you know the full story. Everything in this world is here for assessment of the potency of threat. How potent is it? And is it ready yet to threaten reality? And we just keep working on that. Potency of threat assessment. That's it. Welcome to the world. Because that is the world of this action. That's what's actually taking place. And again, there are many people who say, I don't want to know that. I don't want to know that. I don't want to know that. Don't tell me these things. I don't want to hear it. They put their hands out, you know, over their ears and hands over their eyes. And just stay away. Stay away. Don't say these things. You're terrible. You're terrible. You're terrible. Because we think that we need to figure it out, you know, how to develop this threat to reality. That's the whole purpose of this universe of existence. That's it. And we feel that our only way to salvation is to actually succeed at this endeavor. And what I'm saying is no. One, you cannot ever succeed at that endeavor. You cannot threaten reality in any way. And two, the only way to be saved is to choose a different idea. Drop this whole scenario of trying to threaten reality. That's it. There's no other way. 1 second here. Be right back. All right, just a brief time out there. Again, it is so important in these times to find out where you stand. Can you handle being told about the universe or what its real purpose is? And if you can, then you say, oh my gosh, I don't want to keep doing this. I want to choose a new idea. And so my purpose here is simply to continue to explain what the universe, the purpose, more and more clearly, so you can hear it, have the option. But I have found that most in this world don't want to hear it. Again, they feel their salvation is entirely dependent on developing this threat successfully. And what I say is there's zero possibility of that ever happening, none. And your salvation is dependent on you choosing a new idea, deciding you don't want to be prime creator. Therefore, you don't need to develop any threat to reality, to the prime creator. You don't need reality changed. You don't need to threaten prime creator to force the change. You don't need any of that. So you don't need any trauma. You don't need any threat. You don't need any assessment of trauma or threat on anything. You don't need any of that. You can simply abide in unconditional love, which is the overlay. The idea of not trying to be prime creator gives you that overlay of unconditional love. That is salvation. It's the only salvation, the only way. Salvation won't come by successfully developing a threat to reality. Never. So all of this stuff, all this game we're playing of the victimhood, being victimized by trauma and threat and attack and all that, is a waste of time. It's useless. All this data we've accumulated is useless. All the data. All the data that's ever been accumulated in the universe is completely useless. It has no purpose whatsoever. So don't worry about losing this data or you're not aware of the data. It's all zero. You can sum up all the data that's ever been collected in the universe as simply zero. So if you worried about losing all this data, just say, okay, well, I know it's zero and that's everything. Not a problem. And of course, there are other, the assessment of threat is across the board. But generally, it comes upon us unexpectedly in a way like, seems to overwhelm us, like we weren't prepared for it. And even when we get warnings, we don't prepare for it. If there are watchdogs that say, hey, this is coming, we still don't prepare for it. We turn a deaf ear to all of that because we think, what good is that? The prime creator is not going to be warned by it because the prime creator seems to be oblivious to it. So we need to figure out how do you attack, threaten someone who's oblivious to the threat. That is what we're working on. So of course, we place a premium on those who pretend to be oblivious to what is coming. And we have all sorts of teachings that some of them are called spiritual that try and get people in this state of obliviousness to threat here. That's different than choosing a new idea. It means that they are just setting themselves up as fall guys, patsies, setting up themselves up as patsies. That's it. And they're very determined for it. And, you look at the self-destructive nature of what's taking place in the world, and for me it's so completely obvious. And I say, well, how in the world can I help these people? I've tried. They get angry, very angry. They call you all sorts of names, like you're terrible. Because they want this destructiveness to take place. They wanted themselves to be cast into the fire. They wanted all that to happen. And they're very angry if you try and point out what's going on, because then they might have to assess things, you know, and they think, well, I'm not totally naive to what's taking place, and that's going to ruin the experiment. It's going to affect it in some way. They don't want that. They want to march right into the fire, oblivious, like they'll march over the cliff, just not even realizing it's there, and just suddenly, poof, like Wile E. Coyote, you know, run, pew, gone. That's what they want to do. So how can you help people like that? You cannot. You cannot. In fact, they don't take it as help. They take it as interference. You're interfering with their salvation. That is how they view the whole situation. This is just the straight out facts I'm telling you. The vast majority of this planet, if you tell what I'm telling you here, will take it that somehow this is interfering with their salvation in a severe manner, and that therefore this is most extremely unwelcome. That is a fact. Only a few people on the planet would welcome this and say, ah, you know, I see. Good. Thank you. This is what I want to hear. This is what I'm looking for. And not get upset about it. Because I realize all this assessment of threat is a waste of time. It's futile. Gets us nowhere. So why not be aware of what's going to take place? Why not save ourselves some time? Why not sidestep it all? Why not say, forget it, I don't want to participate in all this? But you will find that when you try to tell others this, that they will get very upset with you. So it's really difficult to move this information out in the world. Very difficult. It just doesn't happen, because people, they don't want to hear this. You might see it and say, yeah, but then you look at your friends and your family and they think you're absolutely nuts. They'll get so upset. More than nuts, they think you're wicked. They think you're interfering with their salvation to an extreme extent. And therefore, they think their assessment is you must be evil, you must be wicked. That is really how they see it. So I try not to say anything to those who don't want to hear it. Now, of course, on YouTube, everyone has the right to not watch. You know, it's optional. It's not like I'm going to a family member and saying blah 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 blah, you know, and they have to listen because they're a family member. And I'm right there talking to them. No, they don't want that. But here, you know, if you don't like it, you click. You know, that's it. So it's a much gentler, kinder type of approach. But there again, if you hear it and you know it's true, you try to help your loved ones and your family and circle of friends and all this stuff. And they'll hate you for it. Jesus said you'll be hated in my name. You know, if you try to spread this, you'll be hated by the world. The world will hate you. That is very true. Very, very true. They don't want to hear anything about this. They feel that you are ruining their chances at salvation if you keep telling them this and they listen to you. So they'll try to get as far away as possible from you. They don't want anything to do with you. That's what I found in my life. You know, people have not wanted to have anything to do with me whatsoever because they're afraid I might spill the beans on the upcoming trauma. They might find out about it. And that will ruin their salvation according to their belief system. Whereas it's just the opposite. The truth is actually opposite. What they're trying to do, there is no salvation with what they're trying to do. None whatsoever. No threat will ever be developed that threatens reality in the slightest bit. Never. No matter how much time we spend trying to develop this threat. Never. And no matter how much we keep assessing and experimenting, never. It's all 100% waste of time, entirely, from the very beginning. All of existence, the whole universe, is a complete waste of time. Total waste of time. Absolutely meaningless. Zero. And so you don't have to continue on with what is meaningless and waste of time. You can choose a different idea and experience unconditional love where there's no trauma, no threat assessment necessary. And that's what we want. We don't want to be continually assessing threat. As we go about our day, we're assessing threat every moment of the day. Every moment of the day. It's in the background. A lot of it's in the background. But it's still there. I mean, you hear the airplane droning overhead, you'd say, oh, I hope the airplane doesn't fall, you know, I hope it doesn't drop any bombs on us, I hope it doesn't. It's subtle. every little thing. I hope that, you know, everything works out okay. I wonder if, you know, driving, I hope I don't get an accident. I hope no one hits me, or I don't hit somebody else. I hope I don't run over somebody who's a bicyclist or a pedestrian. I hope the car doesn't stall. So all these subtle things. Our whole life is completely interlaced, utterly saturated with threat assessment. That's all the universe is threat assessment. That's it. And we sugarcoat it, of course, again, trying to simulate reality. Like, okay, the attitude of reality is everything's wonderful, perfect. So we try to simulate that, and then the universe saying, oh, no, what threat? No, there's no threat. I thought everything's fine. I feel great. I'm happy. I'm a happy person. And, you know, just being completely dishonest about the fact that actually beneath the surface veneer, facade, there's this tremendous threat assessment taking place constantly. That's all that we're about. Assessment of threat. In relationships, you know. What are they going to be like? They're going to steal. Who's going to steal who away? And how things are going to change? And money, you know. On and on. Every facet of existence. Everything is threatened in existence. So we're constantly assessing. Whereas, choose a new idea, unconditional love. No threat assessment is necessary. Because we're not trying to develop a threat to reality. Because we don't need to the prime creator to change reality. Because we're not asking to become prime creator. We're accepting our reality as it is. We're accepting ourselves as spirit as we are. So we don't need any threat. Don't need any threat assessment. We simply abide in this unconditional love. Don't need to be collecting any data on anything. Right? Data is just really threat assessment. Even though we think we're, you know, we're just all happy and having this wonderful life. No, we're not. We are fanatical threat assessors. Fanatical. Completely fanatical. And we continually use these instruments we call body. Bodies are just measurement devices, instruments to assess threat. Oh, means we use to assess threat, like a thermometer, putting a thermometer in some liquid and starting to heat it up and see, you know, what happens to the thermometer. How hot does it get? Humans are bodies are like that, and so we're just here relaying, and like a measurement device, relaying the trauma, the threat, how do we feel, we're suffering, and et cetera, et cetera. And it seems, you know, very negative to say this. It's not negative to say it. If there's a fire in someone's house and you yell fire, that's not being negative. That's just being helpful. It's saying, hey, get out of the house, it's on fire. So if I say, you know, the world is nothing but a threat assessment, that's all that it is, assessing the potency of threat. That's all that it is. There's nothing more to it than that. That's just saying, hey, look, see, your belief that you're going to be saved is only causing you more trauma. The universe is going to save you in this way. It's only leading you into worse and worse and worse trauma. Terrible. So get out of that idea and choose a new idea, and then you won't have to keep doing this. So it's only helpful. But again, only the wise can take it that way, see it that way. That, this is helpful. Most see it as very threatening. It's threatening their what they presume to be their salvation, which again is to develop this a real threat, an actual threat to reality that the prime creator then must take account for and say, uh-oh, if I don't capitulate and change reality and make spirit prime creator, this spirit's going to wipe out all of reality. So the lesser of two evils is I better change it. Got no choice. No choice. Have to do it. You know, that's what existence is all about. That's what it's attempting to accomplish. And it'll never be accomplished. Reality is immaculate, invulnerable, can never be threatened, because the prime creator did not create anything that had any power to threaten reality. Okay, no capacity. We have no capacity to develop any such power. So it will never take place. So our belief that our salvation rests upon this taking place is a false hope that only leads us to more and more suffering. True hope comes from choosing a new idea, focusing on that. Let me choose the idea of not trying to change reality, not trying to develop some threat to reality. And so you experience that which is not any effort to threaten reality. No trauma. That which cannot be traumatized. That which cannot be attacked. That which cannot be harmed in any way. And that which is not collecting any data, any trauma data, any attack data, simply resting in itself, abiding in itself, perfect, in perfect peace. That's called unconditional love. No conditions. Doesn't put any conditions upon accepting this. All are welcome to accept this and experience it, unconditional love. And again, the difficulty I've experienced in this world, in speaking the truth here, again, it seems to conflict with what the idea of salvation the world has, which is to succeed at this endeavor of developing a threat, or some a way to actually threaten reality. It seems to short-circuit it. And you know, nothing I say can actually short-circuit it, but we can choose to a new idea. That's not short-circuiting it. It's just setting it down, gently exchanging it. There's no short-circuit. And the difficulty any of you have, if you want to help others, is you will find out this bizarre situation where they don't want to be helped. They don't want to be warned. It's totally bizarre. Totally bizarre. You wonder, you know, what in the world? How come I can't help these people? It's like you see somebody walking along a path, and they're walking right towards a cliff, and you say, hey, yell at them, and they look at you like, and they say, shut up. And you say, hey, you're walking towards a cliff, come on, you don't seem to be paying attention, you know, you got you're looking up high in the sky, you know, and they say, what are you talking about, you must be crazy, and you keep talking, they put their hands over their ears. What do you do? You know, this is unbelievable. It's traumatic for you because you can't help people, really. So there is that trauma in trying to help the world. The world doesn't listen. And you think, oh, if only they would listen, you know, but no, they won't. They won't listen. Because they think you're interfering with their salvation. So pretty much all you can do is save, you know, for you, choose a new idea. That's pretty much all you can do. And others then will see, whoa, what's going on with you? And they might pay attention to that. But as far as trying to warn people, it doesn't really work. It doesn't work. What really might work is to, again, choose a new idea, abide in unconditional love, and then that will attract people in some way. They'll say, ah, there's something there I like. What is it? And then maybe they'll pay a little bit of attention to what you say. But as far as simply just warning people, being a watchdog, doesn't work. I've had a lifetime of being a watchdog. It doesn't work. Doesn't work. Doesn't get anywhere. In fact, you find yourself isolated. Again, because nobody wants to hear that. They call you, you're a downer. You're a wet blanket. You know, that's what they say. Ah, no, you're negative. That's it. You're a negative person. I don't want any negative people around me. I say, look, I'm just telling you, you're about ready to walk off a cliff. How is that negative? I'm just telling you, your house is on fire. Get out. How is that negative? I didn't make the fire. I didn't put the cliff there. I'm not walking along there. Come on. It's a positive thing. I'm saying, take a positive step and choose a new idea. And stop trying to assess the potency of threat. It's not negative at all. But I'll see it as being negative. So I tried to, you know, suppress all that. Trying to be more positive, you know, positive person. Say, ah, everything's fine, everything's great, done. You know, don't worry about it. Maybe some little things, but nothing big. But it's not true. And it's not true, that's a lie. But there's a way of being negative or pointing out stuff without being, you know, actually negative at all. I'm not being negative here because I'm giving true hope, showing you where success is. I'm saying, get out, house on fire, run out the front door, get outside. That's where, you know, that's how you'll escape the fire. That's a positive advice. That's helpful advice. It's not negative at all. I'm just telling you, this is what existence is. This is what the universe is. Assessing the potency of threat and continually trying to develop greater and greater potency of threat, hoping that it'll eventually morph or be catalyzed into actual threat. That's all that the universe is. And you're the person, the body, all this. This is just a instrument, a measurement device of assessing threat, assessing the potency of threat. And you don't have to continue on with that process. Even when you choose another idea, the body is no longer an instrument assessing threat or measuring threat. It loses its measuring capability. The body is no longer, you know, concerned with that. It doesn't feel, you know, threat. Doesn't feel any of that. And of course people say, what good is this body? It's useless. Useless to us. It has no benefit because it can't assess anything. Completely crazy, stupid. And you know that's not true. So as things heat up, as they're heating up, of course, they will heat up. And because the time for assessing the potency of trauma is upon us. We're always working on it. That's all the universe does. But there's some times where we really, you know, work on it more intensely, more compressed in time. And we're at that time right now. You know, the last 100 years have seen some incredibly compressed trauma in this world, and you know, we're now at a point where it's going to be even more compressed trauma, even worse than before. And everyone here wants to expose themselves to this trauma so they can assess, you know, collect all this data of, you know, how bad was the trauma for me, what situation was I in, everything that's happened in the universe. Records are kept, like it's being tape recorded, kind of like digitally recorded. And so then all this is being culled down into data. And then we're like scientists, and then we're examining all this data and trying to assess, you know, how much progress we've made, what's the next step in threat. You know, we need to make all more bodies, more worlds, and then set up scenario that causes even greater trauma, more severe trauma. Do we need to make a more sophisticated measuring instruments of trauma than bodies, human bodies, you know, and all of this? We just keep on doing that, building up all these data banks, trying to figure out how can we actually succeed. And so everyone here is like that. They're all these, you know, like mad scientists wanting to subject the bodies and personas to all this trauma. But if you choose a different idea, you have no reason to subject the body or the persona to any trauma. No reason to do it whatsoever. Now it may be that, you know, you can't feel any trauma at all, which is true. You won't be able to. At the same hand, you don't have any desire to play, you know, play that game or be on that playing field, so to speak. Even though, you know, you're not affected, it's like you're walking on, you know, a battlefield and everything's happening around you. You're not even touched by it, but you know, you don't particularly want to be walking on the battlefield, really. May not make a difference one way or the other, but as far, you know, maybe to help others, you may not want to be doing that. I don't know. It's up to each one of us how that plays out. But by and large, I would say sidestepping this whole planetary sacrifice thing is a very good idea. We don't want to be tempted to get back into that stuff, you know. Our resolve is kind of fragile right now. Now, if we are perfectly, you know, we've chosen a new idea and we've abided in that new unconditional love, then we could walk in this world and not even be tempted by it, to assess trauma at all, not even be tempted by it. But we're not at that place right now. Only a very few have ever come into this world like that. Very few. We are not like that yet. So it's a bad idea to try and play that game, you know, of like, oh, you know, nothing... I'm not the slightest bit interested in assessing any trauma whatsoever. So I will not. I'll stay right with unconditional love. No, we will be tempted. If we stay here, we'll be tempted. It's like driving past a train wreck, you know, a vast train wreck. Let's say you're driving along and there's some off the side of the road, there's a train track, and some horrific train wreck is taking place. And you say, well, I'm just going to keep driving. I'm not going to, you know, look at it. And you drive and drive and drive and drive, and out of the corner of your eye, you see, oh my gosh, there's still, you know, no matter how far you drive, there's more and more to this train wreck. Another car, you see, this car and that car. This car's in flames. This car's smoking. This car's people are jumping out of windows. This car, people are screaming. This car's dead bodies everywhere. This car, you know, is twisted this way. This one's twisted that way. Every single car, you know, is like some different trauma, and you keep driving, and the train go on forever, and at some point you're gonna be tempted to say, wow, let me look at this train, you know, let me slow down the car and look at this, you know, trauma. Wow, what has happened here? You know, some point you're going to be tempted to do that. So it's better to sidestep it. It's better to head for the hills and not even tempt yourself. Really, that's the path I want to take. That's the path I'm trying to take. Because realistically, if you know the truth that's been spoken here about the universe, about the purpose of the universe, and about false path of salvation and the true path of salvation, which is to choose a new idea, and you know that's true, and yet you haven't done it yet, why tempt yourself to indulge in a threat assessment, potency of threat? Why even tempt yourself that way? Why not get as far away from it as possible? Why not go to a situation where the threat is either, you know, much, much less, much milder, or where you can even go to a place where there's no threat at all? Those are some possibilities. But at least go in that direction. That's what I want to do now, is to go in that direction, to back away from the threat assessment, back away from situations, you know, that are getting very volatile, and start taking steps to back away even further. That is the wise thing to do. In other words, protect your sanity, because you're not yet completely established and confirmed in that sanity. It's fragile. It's fragile. Your resolve is fragile. Our resolve is fragile at this time. You know, with very few exceptions in this world, our resolve is very fragile. So instead of, you know, just leaving yourself wide open to all the trauma that's happening in the world and will be happening, and thinking that you can, you know, just you can tune it out, why not take some steps away from it? You know, why linger at the edge of the cliff? Why? You might be tempted to walk over the edge. I used to go to cliffs. I used to test that out to see, you know, what was going on in the dynamic of the world. I'd get near a cliff, I'd say, oh, no way, no way, no way. Because there's something inside, there's something self-destructive in all of us that wants to assess threat, you know, that wants to assess trauma. And so I was aware of that. I said, ah, there's this desire to assess trauma. And then I would say, no, I don't want to be right at the edge of a cliff and whistling, saying, oh, there's no temptation, you know, to jump over the cliff or something. Because there is within us, everybody. Some people pretend that there isn't. But later on in life, you find out somehow they fell off a cliff or something, you know. they're just in denying it, trying to pretend it's not there. Whereas I just was objective and looked at it and said, okay. So I backed away from the cliff, saying, no, I'm not going to stand close to the edge of a cliff. That's just stupid. Stuff can happen. Stuff happens. Why take that risk when your resolve is still fragile? Why pretend that you're someone whose complete resolve is totally set when it's not? Again, there's very few in this world whose resolve is totally set to choose a new idea. Very few who have chosen a new idea, and very few whose resolve is strong to do that. And even in my situation, I say my resolve is not strong enough so that I could stand at the edge of a cliff and feel perfectly safe in doing that. No way. That's just stupid. That's called spiritual pride, to believe that. Because the temptation in this world to assess threat, the potency of threat, is going to become super strong. Super strong. And you will, you know, it's like someone who's been an alcoholic for, you know, a billion years, and they're finally off the bottle for a little while, for a couple years, you know. and they think they can wander into a Bacchanalian, you know, situation where everybody's just pouring and drinking like crazy and giving everybody else drinks and laugh. You know, they think they could just walk through that endless party and not even be tempted in the slightest bit. That is lunacy. That's foolhardiness. You know, the one who really wants to succeed will say, whoa, no, I'm not going to any party like that. No way. Know your weaknesses. Know the fragility of your resolve. We have to know our limitations. And the fragility of our resolve is there. And so that's why I say, hey, consider taking steps to distance yourself from trauma assessment, from the trauma, the temptation to assess trauma, both in others and in yourself. Back away from that. And that's where my intention is. That's where my intention has been for a long time. And it's getting to the point now where I feel I need to make another step at this point. Where I am right now, it has always been a place that's quite distant from trauma. But I cannot guarantee it will remain that way in the future. So I feel I need to take a further step away from that all. And you know, set the example. Instead of testing the fragility out by wandering into traumatic situations like I'm some kind of savior and tell people, look people, I'm not asking anything. That's misleading for people. Very misleading. It's not what people should do, because I guarantee you that the fragility of almost everybody on this planet is very severe. The resolve is very feeble. Almost everyone, including most spiritual teachers on this planet, their resolve is very fragile, if they even have the resolve. So they themselves should not pretend that they're some kind of spiritual hero and say, look people, I'm not tempted, you know, at all. That's nonsense. That's like lemmings. They'll be swept over the cliff by all the pressure of the other lemmings. All the buffalo stampeding will push. There might be one buffalo in the stampede is saying, hey, I don't want to jump over that edge. Yeah, but there's a million buffalo behind that one pushing them, you know, like an inexorable waterfall or Niagara Falls, you know, going to go over. So that's foolish. That's very foolhardy now. I know there are a lot of people still thinking, oh, we can ride this one out. You know, yeah, we can be in the midst of the storm and we can handle it. Nah, that's stupid. Very stupid. If anything I can convey to anyone in the world, it's this. Don't be stupid. Don't believe in your spiritual pride. Don't trust it. Don't trust that your resolve is kind of super resolve. Because if it was, you would have probably already chosen a new idea, and you would already know exactly what I'm talking about. In fact, you'd know it way better than I'm talking about it. And you wouldn't have a shred of doubt, and you wouldn't have a shred of fear. And you would be like Ramana Maharshi or Anandamayi Ma. You would literally be like that. You would be abiding in unconditional love continuously with this supreme, vast indifference to the world and not experiencing the slightest trauma or irritation whatsoever. You'd already be there. And since you're not, and we'd be aware of you, you're not there, you know. So you're not there at all. Your resolve is still very feeble. Even some of the top spiritual teachers on this planet, their resolve is still very feeble. It's obvious. So again, set the right example for everyone and back away. Take steps back away from the trauma, from the serious and, you know, stuff. Get away from the front lines. Don't be wandering out in the front lines showing off your resolve. Because you will likely lose your resolve, and then other people will see that and they'll say, oh my gosh, even they lost their resolve. That means even they really believe that salvation is through assessing the potency of threat and trauma. And then they'll go for it even more because they think, wow, look at this spiritual teacher. And they finally changed their mind and decided to support this whole thing. And you see that, it's really funny. In the world right now, you see people caving in right and left, supporting this whole sacrificial scenario and the leaders of it, etc. Say, yeah, we support all this. And so the caving in, the more it happens, it's like an avalanche. It's an avalanche. And I'm aware of that too. You will find this whole domino effect of people caving in and deciding to go along with the sacrifice. And there's this whole group dynamic as it accelerates like an avalanche. you know, nobody's going to be safe. The only ones who would be safe would be like someone like Ramana or Nandamayama, someone like that. They would be 100% safe, not even touched by it the slightest bit. Other than that, no, you're going to be swept away by it. Swept away, buried by the avalanche, and you'll lose your resolve. Jesus said to Peter, you know, you're going to deny me three times for the rooster crows thrice. You know, before the rooster crows thrice, you will deny me three times. And Peter said, ah, no way. No way. Impossible. You're crazy. Jesus was pointing out this dynamic. You know, Peter's resolve was feeble, fragile. And Jesus was just pointing out, hey, you know, you think that you've got this super resolve. You don't. You've got a little bit of resolve, but easily you'll deny it. Easily you'll fall back. So don't put yourself in a situation where you're put to the test. Don't put yourself to the test. It's stupid. And so this is what I'm so adamantly conveying. Don't put yourself to the test. It's stupid. It's foolish. It's foolhardy. Okay. And with that, we're going to bring this video to a close.